Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, the one person you probably don't recognize up here is the one who just read the gospel. It's Father Chris Allar, one of the Marians of the Immaculate, who's come here with great adventure last night through the American Canadian Customs. We weren't sure he was going to be able to be here, but somehow or other, the customs agent who came was Polish. And he heard about this devout Faustina and other adventures. Anyway, you might hear about it later in the day. We're happy that you're with us here, Father Chris. The feast in honor of Our Lady of Guadalupe goes back to the 16th century, as you probably know. Chronicles from that period tell us the story. A poor Indian named Cuatlacoac was baptized and given the name Juan Diego, John James. He was a 57-year-old widower and lived in near Mexico City. Like us, today, on a Saturday morning, he was on his way to a nearby barrio to attend Mass in honor of Our Lady. It was December the 9th, 1531. As he walked by a hill called Tepeyac, he heard beautiful music, like the warbling of birds. A radiant cloud appeared, and within it a young Native American maiden dressed like an Aztec princess. The lady spoke to him in his own language and sent him to the Bishop of Mexico, a Franciscan named Juan de Zumarraga. The bishop was told to build a chapel in the place where the lady appeared. I can identify with the bishop. People are always coming to say, "The Lord set it on my heart. Our Blessed Mother wants this. Please do that." And they can do it by email now. They don't have to come. Eventually, the bishop told Juan Diego to have the lady give him a sign. And a very interesting thing, because Our Lady obeys the bishop. Take note of that, all of you. About this time, Juan Diego's uncle became seriously ill, and this led poor Diego to try to avoid the lady. But the lady is not going to be avoided, you know Our Lady. The lady found Diego, assured him that his uncle would recover, and provided roses for Juan to carry to the bishop in his cape or his tilma. They were the kind of roses that grow in Spain, where the bishop had come from. They didn't normally grow in December in Mexico. When Juan Diego opened his tilma in the bishop's presence, the roses fell to the ground and the bishop sank to his knees. For on Juan Diego's tilma was an image of Mary, as she had appeared at the hill of Tepeyac. It was December the 12th, 1531. Mary's appearance to Juan Diego as one of his people is a powerful reminder that Mary and the God who sent her accept all peoples in the context of the rude and cruel treatment that was going on by the Indians by the Spanish at that time. This appearance, this apparition, was a rebuke to the Spaniards, and it's an event of vast significance for Native Americans, and not just for them, for us too. And that's why in Canada and other parts of Americas, today is the National Day of Prayer and Solidarity with Indigenous peoples. So remember the Native people of Canada today. While a number of Native people had converted before this incident, they now came in droves. According to a contemporary chronicler, 9 million Indians became Catholics in a very short time. That must have been quite an RCIA program they had. In these days, when we hear so much about God's preferential option for the poor, Our Lady of Guadalupe cries out to us that God's love for and identification with the poor is an age-old truth that stems from the gospel itself. And that's what's said in the Magnificat, the Mary prays today. The Lord casts down the mighty and lifts up the lowly. Invites us to be like Father Jeff, humble, behind the scenes. He tells us he's proud of his humility. I'm sorry, Father Jeff, I shouldn't have. Guadalupe, Mother of the Civilization of Love, is the title of this light book by Supreme Knight of Columbus, Carl Anderson, and Father Eduardo Chavez, a Mexican scholar of the Guadalupe Miracles. Anderson and Chavez recount the visitation using several sources, including the testimony of Juan Diego itself, as well as that of his contemporaries. I knew the outlines of the story, but I didn't realize how the Virgin spoke to Juan Diego in his native tongue, using phrases and in terms of endearment that a mother would use towards her son or child. As she did later on at Lourdes and Fatima, Mary chose her messenger from among the lowest of the low. The image of Our Lady of Guadalupe is miraculous and resists the scientific examinations of the tilma that has undergone over the centuries. The simple garment has withstood deterioration, the lack of damage from acid and bombs. The book also reveals the complex symbolism of the painting. And today, as the people in France are waiting to sign a document urging the whole world to stop global warming if we can, Our Lady stands on all of creation. She stands on the moon, the stars, the sun. There's the real focus of our attention should be Our Blessed Mother and how she tells us about God's will. We share Mary as our mother, and she shares with us her son, who showed himself as the embodiment of God's mercy in speaking at another time in the 20th century with apparently insignificant religious sister named Faustina Kowalska. Pope Francis has decided to have an extraordinary jubilee year dedicated to the mercy of God. We know that it was St. John Paul II who put divine mercy at the center of the Church's proclamation. Before that, it was really a devotion in Poland and some parts where the Poles had gone. But now it's part of the universal Church. Today, most parishes in Canada have images of divine mercy, like the one that's over here, or the one I showed Father Chris at our cathedral this morning. Preaching at John Paul's funeral in 2005, Cardinal Joseph Ratzinger, soon to be elected Pope, proposed divine mercy as the central truth of St. John Paul's historical pontificate. Pope John Paul II has said that divine mercy is the limit God puts to the evil in the world. It was an insight that John Paul had formed as a young man in Krakow, forced to endure the Nazi occupation, only to be liberated by something worse, the tyranny of the communists. The logic of totalitarianism is based on violence. The one who controls the means of violence and is willing to use them wields power. But the way that mercy works is that the strong use one's power to lift up the weak, as God does. The tyrant considers this weakness pure and simple. In communism, salvation for the slave meant rising up against the master, overthrowing him, taking his place. The master, in turn, had to learn to keep the slave down, lest the reversal of fortune render him a slave himself. John Paul proposed that older and more real than the master-slave rivalry is the father-son relationship. It's more real, for it corresponds to the Trinitarian nature of God as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. The Father from all eternity begets the Son in love, and their love is the Spirit. Hence, when John Paul returned to Poland in 1979 and a million people chanted, "We want God," in Warsaw's Victory Square, it was not merely the expression of piety, but a rejection of the logic of communist violence. In the 21st century, the proposal of mercy remains provocative. So Pope Francis has chosen this theme, Merciful Like the Father, which is also the theme of our diocese this year, for the pastoral year. We've made the saying of Jesus in Luke 36:36 our own. Be merciful as your heavenly Father is merciful. Francis proposes too, like John Paul before him, that fatherhood, rather than tyranny, is the proper reading of human history. First of all, God is to be understood as a father who uses his power to lift up the weak, to bind up their wounds. Favorite phrase, Pope Francis. God should not be seen as omnipotent one before whom submission is required, but rather the gentle, tender one. Pope Francis talking about the need the Church has for a revolution of tenderness. Tasting and living and handing on the compassion of God. Secondly, the merciful fatherhood of God is a sharp challenge to the prevailing ethos of secularism, the thing that eats away at our faith. Like Chris and I were talking about Quebec. How could a Quebec that had a practice of 90% when I was growing up in Montreal lead now to a practice of 2-3% or something? It's not just a reaction against the past, but it's kind of being eaten away by consumerism, by other values. The teaching of compassion and mercy flies in the face of radical autonomy and self-sufficiency that secularism proclaims. Fatherhood himself implies both the dependence of a son on the father and the relation of a father and a son to each other, and a spirit of gratitude, neither of which is congenial to the idea of the self-made person. It's noteworthy that in the push for euthanasia, as Father D'Souza said in a column this week in the National Post, the older term mercy killing has been entirely left aside. Not only because killing sounds like bad public policy, of course Quebec wants people to be able to kill themselves, as we've been talking about this week, but because death is to be embraced as the final act of an autonomous triumph of self. The 21st century man is not so much searching for mercy, despairing of where to find it, but rather considers himself not to need mercy at all. The human person today, the self-made person, desires recognition of his own personal strength. He must be a master, and mercy is for slaves. I was really moved when Pope John Paul II wrote his book, Divus in Misericordia, God is Rich in Mercy, that to show mercy is not to look down upon a person, but to really care for them. And that's what the prodigal father does to his son, to both sons, the son who went away, the son who's at home. The one who's at home doesn't know he's loved, but he has a father. So today, as we come to listen to Father Chris share with us insights in the devotion of divine mercy, we pray that each one of us may know ourselves as a son or daughter in the embrace of the Father. And knowing that ourselves, that we will want, in the spirit of evangelization, the new evangelization, to share with other people. Let's pray that Our Lady of Guadalupe, who knew how to be tender and compassionate and kind to a lowly widower, empty because he lost his wife, because he had an uncle who was sick, that she will also encourage us to know that we are loved by God, that we will know that she is our mother as well. And if she is our mother, we have nothing to fear. So we bless God today for coming to know the Divine Mercy devotion. We pray that we may learn more about it, but not only learn about it in the head, but in our hearts, so we can share with others. I hope the Lord will bless you in a richly abundant way today. Please pray for me and for our priests that we, in the sacrament of reconciliation, we always be kind and welcoming and show the mercy of God, not be anywhere rough or condescending or difficult with penitence, but really compassionate like the Father is. Please pray for us, we pray for you. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.